Nós vamos então convidar com carinho o nosso amigo e irmão Daniel.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How are you today?
Well.
It's truly a pleasure to be here with you today. I am very excited to have a chance to visit with you one more time and to talk about a topic I find extremely important and necessary. Our hope today is to talk for about 45 minutes or so, I think. And I beg for your indulgence as we're going to go through the whole period of time. And then at the end, if we have time, we'll do questions and answers. But I just want to make sure that we get through this because it's truly a problem that affects all of us. Is that okay? All right. Suicide. What if death is not the end? It was September of 2018 when I was working at home. Busy with some sort of deadline, which always seems to loom when you are working, I get a call from one of my colleagues saying, "Hey, have you checked Andre's Facebook?" And I'm like, "Not now, right? I am trying to deliver this report. There's something coming up." And then she says, "You should really check out his Facebook." And at that second, I thought that was a nuisance. That was something that maybe was going to be an HR issue. Maybe he said something inappropriate or perhaps something that could ruin our work since we work in education and sometimes opinions and things matter. But when I get to Facebook and see his feed, I see that about 20 minutes before, he has written a goodbye letter. It's a long post in which he thanks people for having helped him in his life, says messages to specific people, and says that he's checking out, that he's done living. And I confess to you, I had to read it two or three times. I just couldn't believe it. Because Andre was the kind of people, the kind of person that people went to when they had problems. He was the kind of guy that was always smiling, always ready to work and help people out. And to read that message all of a sudden caught me by surprise, because I just couldn't think that of all people that I knew and I worked with, Andre was the one who says, "I no longer want to live." And you can only imagine how this affects somebody when you have this kind of news. And we immediately kicked into troubleshooting mode. I immediately called him and he wouldn't pick up his phone. I called his former wife. I texted him. I called Verizon Wireless because he had a phone assigned by work that we paid the bill on. So I was hoping that Verizon could help us locate his position. Because I had said that even though, I haven't noticed that even though he hadn't replied to any of my calls or messages, that on the text message thing, it said red. So I knew that he was still with us. And a bunch of us at work who were close to him and knew about this were also calling him and texting him, just telling him that we cared for him. And that went on for another hour or so. Eventually, we called the police as well. And long story short, we were lucky that about an hour and a half after that, he told one of our coworkers where he was. And the police was able to get there and apprehend him and take him to the hospital for some help. But the story doesn't end there. Because after the mandatory hold, he came out and everything seemed to be okay. Until a month later, he again tried to commit suicide. And at this point in time, you can only imagine the sense of helplessness and desperation of those who care about him, to think that, oh my goodness, he's doing that again. One more time, we were able to text message him and he started replying back to us. And again, we were able to get him help. When he came out of the hospital for the second time, he mentioned that this time things were a lot better because he was taking the medication that was prescribed to him, and it was really helping him. And we were really excited about that. 2 months later, again, I got a call from another coworker saying, I think Andre is attempting suicide again. And I can only tell you that is the most horrible feeling when you have somebody you care for thinking that life is enough for them, that they're done. This time though, as we were text messaging back and forth, myself and other folks who care for him, he himself walked away from it. He said, I was having these things, I will no longer do that, I'm going to go to the hospital. So that was really great to hear. But why do I tell you that? I tell you that because this is an all too common story. It happens more often than we know. It's also so prevalent that sometimes we don't understand that it could happen to people who are close to us, and that those who are close to us oftentimes are struggling with issues that we have not noticed because we weren't paying attention. And so my hope today is to shed some light into how Spiritism can maybe offer an additional way in which we can help folks who may be considering ending their own life. And the way I think we can do that is by sharing some of the insights that we have learned through our own research, our own Spiritist research, on the fact that life does not end after the physical body. You see, people who are trying to end their lives and commit suicide, they're not trying to die. They're trying to end their suffering. And they just believe that if they end their lives, they will therefore end their suffering. Thank you. If we can show that life does not end, maybe we can dissuade them to think that killing themselves is a solution to their problems. And maybe it would also offer some hope that because life goes on, there is a lot of love and support for us out there. And so in the next 40 minutes or so, I hope to present you with some facts that may help you make an informed case as to why life continues after the physical body perishes. And hopefully that is knowledge that you yourself can use to strengthen your conviction that life goes on. Or maybe this is something you can share with others who may be struggling, and who knows, plant a little doubt in their heads as to whether life really ends. Because if we are able to at least elicit the question, we might be able to help somebody not make a regrettable decision. Does that make sense? Okay. So, what if death is not the end? Suicide really is a common problem. The problem, in fact, is so common that I want to share this number with you. 42,773. That's the number of deaths by suicide in the United States and in the United States alone in 2014, according to the American Foundation for Suicide Prevention. 42,773. That's a lot of people. But let me further break this down for you. That's the equivalent of 5 suicides per hour. That is to say, if you look around, one row of people here would have committed suicide by the time we're done with our talk today. That's far too many. But it gets even more alarming, because once we look into the rates themselves, we see that is the 10th highest cause of death in the United States. And we also see there are 25 attempts for every suicide. So imagine that. Imagine how incredibly widespread this problem is, and that we might just not be aware because we still have not been able to talk about it openly in general. And what's really troubling here too, as you see in this line here, is that the rate of suicides by 100,000 people continues to increase. It's only normal in a way that as population increases, you have more people suiciding. But the way the researchers work this out is by dividing the number of suicide by 100,000 people in the population, so that number is always constant. So you know that even if the population is increasing, you know if the rate of suicide is increasing or not. And it is. And see here, since 2005, the rate has been increasing. That is to say, the more people are choosing to check out on life than ever before. And that is an interesting question. Because we have never had, in the history of humanity, as much comfort as we have today. We have never had as many resources in the history of humanity as we have today. We had never had so much support and possibilities as we have today. So why is it? Why is it that as a society, we think that life is getting harder? It seems to be counterintuitive, but it is. And I think it speaks to a void of purpose and meaning in our lives, an understanding of a spiritual perspective. Because we know by all of this that abundance and things and comfort do not make us happy. We also know that the absence of all these things also do not make us happy. So the question remains, what is it that makes us fulfilled? What is it that really matters? What can help us find a purpose and meaning in our lives so that we don't think that we have to choose a very permanent solution for a temporary problem? Because that's what suicide is. An incredibly permanent solution for a temporary problem that does so much damage to those who stay behind. I can tell you just recently, I had another colleague at work whose wife has committed suicide. And she has left two kids behind, 7 and 9 years of age. What could possibly lead the person to be in so much despair as to think that would solve their problems? Friends, it is more common than we expect. But I think there is reason for hope. I think there are ways for us to address this problem, and that's what I want to share with you today. And I think that the root causes of suicide, like I said, is suffering. And I think it's suffering of two natures. One, an emotional pain, and sometimes an intellective perspective on life too. That is, I think that we need to address both our heart and our mind when we are trying to get rid of this horrible thing that is suicide in our society. So I hope to present today aspects that address both things. And maybe it will make sense to you. So let's dive deeper into this. I want to tell you a little story. And I find this fascinating because I am sometimes deeply touched by the teachings of the Buddha. And the story tells us, in the Four Noble Truths, the story tells us that Buddha, who was an ancient prince that lived about 4,000 years ago, he was sheltered by his father, the king, who wanted him to have the best that he possibly could, as all fathers want for their kids. And so, because he had everything that he possibly could and was sheltered by his father, he had never left the royal palace. He had only the best because his father hoped that he would become a king in the future. And eventually, at around 18 years of age, Siddhartha Gautama, the name of Buddha, is able to convince his father to let him leave the palace to see the world. And he takes his friend with him to be his charioteer. And as they are going into this trip, he sees a couple of scenes that change his perspective. And these are called, within the Buddhist tradition, the four signs. He walks around, and the first time he sees somebody who is sick. And he asks his friends, "What is this?" And his friend tells us, "Somebody who is sick." He had never seen somebody sick before. And he stops to ponder. And as the story goes, he then sees somebody back there who's old, and he had never seen an old person before. So he asks his friend, "Friend, what is that?" "It is an old man, sir." It makes him ponder. The third sign that he sees is that of a corpse. And he asks, "What is that?" "That is a dead man, sir." And he had never seen anybody who had died. And that shakes him to his core. But his fourth sight was of a monk, in pure simplicity, meditating with a smile on his face. And then, it is said, the Buddha achieved wisdom. And he came up with are called the Four Noble Truths, which I find to be an extremely modern and powerful psychological treatise about life and what suffering really is. And he says that there are four important things in this world that we should know. The first one is that life is dukkha. Dukkha is a word in Sanskrit that means suffering and trial, challenges. That's life, right? He says that dukkha comes from attachment to impermanent things, and that's what I think is brilliant. He says that all our suffering comes from attachment to things that are not going to last. When we attach ourselves to things that are not going to last, we are sure to be let down. If we attach ourselves to things like our car, our home, and even relationships, we are going to be disappointed eventually, and so we will suffer. Isn't that brilliant? Super simple and brilliant. And I find that to be in complete alignment with something another great sage said 2,000 years after Buddha, Jesus Christ, when he said, "Gather your treasures in heaven, where thieves do not steal it and where moths do not corrupt it." Right? So we should not put attention to things that are impermanent. We should place all of our attention and our care and our love in things that are permanent. And the Buddha goes on to say that if we eliminate this attachment to impermanent things, we are going to eliminate suffering, therefore be in a state of bliss. And he says that liberation from attachment and from pain comes from the Eightfold Path, which are eight different suggestions that he makes. That we can go into some other time, but speaking the right thing, thinking the right thing, doing the right thing, all great advice, practical advice for our lives. But isn't it interesting that 4,000 years ago, I feel, we have already been given part of the puzzle to understand that a lot of our suffering and pain comes from the fact that we are placing emphasis and importance in things that are not going to last. And when they break down, when they disappear, when they simply go away, we don't know what to do with ourselves. And we oftentimes become aimless. So if we are able to change that perspective, maybe we'll find some extra solutions. And this is where we come in, because I think from an intellectual perspective, we can bring some sort of at least doubt here. What if there is no death? What if life is permanent? What if life goes on after this physical body? And you can say, "Well, Dan, clearly you're biased." Yes, I am biased because I have verified through what I believe are facts, and even scientific facts I want to share with you, that life goes on. So I want to share with you today some of these areas. There are actually six different areas that I think present evidence that there is life after life, or before life. And I want to talk briefly through all of these six so that you have a sense of where to start. Of course, in 25 minutes or so, I won't be able to cover this in depth. Neither am I an expert in all these areas, but I want to present them to you so that should you find it interesting, you know where to go for some more information, which does not preclude for there being more evidence in different areas. But see, these are some of the six areas that I myself have found to be extremely enlightening when it comes to the question of, is there life after life? So let's do it. The first one is spontaneous memories. It's the idea that we can recall memories from a past life. And it's a very interesting and intriguing concept because some people claim to remember past lives. Is that true? Well, that's the question that Dr. Ian Stevenson posed himself. And Dr. Ian Stevenson founded the Division of Psychological Studies in the Psychiatric Medicine Department of the University of Virginia. That is to say, a department within a accredited research university that studied this. And he produced an incredible book called 20 Cases Suggested of Reincarnation, which is this book over here, has a white cover, in 1974, where what he does is he researched cases of preferably kids who have memories from a life before, because kids are not always able to fudge things. They are a lot easier for you to catch on a lie. And oftentimes they don't have any purpose to doing that anyways. So a lot of his cases are of kids in India, in rural India, that have these memories when they are 5, 6 years old, and that they cannot possibly know about, that are in other parts of India or the world. And then he goes out to these different places and check the stories of those kids to see if there's possibly any connection back to that original family. And especially in 1974, you can see how hard that work is because the internet wasn't there and phones weren't really widespread. So in a way, it's even more proof of the possibility that the life that they were reporting to remember actually happened because they could not possibly hear about different parts of the country, of the world. And so he comes with a lot of these cases that you can read in the book, and it's really a research book, so it's not an easy read. It's a very scientific in a way. But there's more than 3,000 cases documented in his research in 40 years of research. Fascinating. And some of the cases are fascinating because some of the kids or subjects displayed a birthmark in the area of the body where they had reported a violent death before. Super interesting things. So I highly recommend that if you are interested in this, you can read many of his books over here. That he published, Dr. Ian Stevenson, one of the potential areas that point to the idea that there is scientific research, that we live before this life. And of course, if we live before this life, that means that our spirit or who we are, our essence, has previously moved from that body to the one that we're in today. So we can say with clarity, the life goes on after the physical body. Are you with me so far? Right. Along those lines too, we have Dr. Carol Bauman. Dr. Carol Bauman, who I had a pleasure of meeting actually in one of our spiritist symposiums a while back, here in Boston, as a matter of fact, wrote a book, Children's Past Lives, right? And Dr. Bauman is an international author, lecturer, counselor, and she's also a regression therapist and pioneer reincarnation studies. She was drawn into the work of Dr. Ian Stevenson because of her own experiences with her kids. One of her kids started to having these memories and she started researching it. And she started to continue to research after that. And one of the things she does is she writes these two books, which are great, including Children's Past Lives, 1997, which she makes the research of Dr. Ian Stevenson's more accessible to us and tells us some of her stories too. So if you're interested in the topic, it might be a good way to start by Dr. Carol Bauman and then make your way to Dr. Ian Stevenson if you are not into academic reading. But it's yet another doctor, research and therapist who went into the idea of past lives after having experienced it firsthand in her family. Again, another resource that you can leverage if you find the idea of spontaneous memories interesting for you to bring some solace into your heart that life really does go on. All right, different area, memory regression. We may have had of Dr. Brian Weiss, who wrote a seminal book called Many Lives, Many Masters in 1988. And Dr. Weiss is a regression therapist. And what happened is really interesting. He was working with some patients that had traumatic experiences. And he was trying to regress them to early childhood so that they could find the cause of their trauma. Because some of these traumas were so intense, they didn't know where it came from. And so he would regress them under hypnosis back to a time in their childhood where there was something that was unearthing. And then by reliving that, the patient was able to understand what was happening and release that traumatic load in a way and feel better about it. But something interesting happened. Oops. Some of them, when told to regress back to the area of their trauma, regressed further than their childhood and started to narrate past experiences in past lives. Isn't that interesting? You can only imagine his surprise. At least I can. He must have done a couple of double takes. Where are you? What year is this? But it's a fascinating read. So if you're interested in some more of research along those lines, you can read one of his books, Many Lives, Many Masters, and his second one called Same Soul, Many Bodies. And again, the idea with memory regression here is the same. Well, if you are regressing to a memory in a life before, then your soul, your essence, whatever you want to call it, must have survived that body to be able to now be you, right? So another evidence. And still along those lines of memory regression, I also want to bring in Dr. Michael Newton, who published a book, Journey of Souls, in 1994. He also does memory regression therapy for traumas. But what is slightly different and interesting with Dr. Newton here is that while he was doing memory regression, some of his patients actually recounted and reported being outside the body between lives. So they were narrating to him what were their memories when they were no longer in a physical body, which is highly interesting because I think it's yet another angle to the idea that, you know what, not only do we live different lives before, but we also live in between lives without a physical body. So if you're interested in that, then you can read a little bit of Dr. Michael Newton's research. With me so far? All right, I want to make sure nobody's sleeping here. Okay. Another interesting field of studies, and I know that we're going through these kind of quickly, but I mean to have them as appetizers for you, so that you can go out and research on your own and develop your own conclusions and your own understanding of these things. Another field is near-death experiences. And that is a term coined by Dr. Michael Moody, which I also had a pleasure of meeting once at a Congress, that narrate or describe the experience of clinical death. That is the common perception among thousands of people that once they achieve clinical death, maybe in the hospital, they're able to perceive things and tell things that they would not otherwise know. And we may have heard of cases, oh yes, I saw a tunnel of white light, or I talked light and I talked to people. And there's some commonalities that people describe. But what's really interesting in his books too, Life After Life, for instance, and Light Beyond, is that there are some cases in which patients who are at a hospital and are clinically dead report, check this out, having heard conversations by people that they do not know in a couple of rooms away from the operating table where they are, and then are able to, once they come back to life, describe that. And how could they have possibly been able to hear a conversation rooms away? I understand that we can say that, well, if they heard a conversation in the room they were in while they were clinically dead, they weren't clinically dead, that their brain just picked up through hearing. But if they actually remember and can describe a conversation a couple of rooms away while they were clinically dead, perhaps it's an evidence that who we are, our essence, and we call soul here, can actually live outside the body and come back to the physical body. I find it fascinating. And of course, there's also Dr. Kubler-Ross over here, who we can talk a little bit more about later, but she has a great book on death and dying and life lessons as well. And perhaps she was responsible for the beginning of the field of transpersonal psychology, a psychology that is more geared towards the spiritual, because of these experiences and because of this research in general. So if you're interested in near-death experiences, a great way to start is with Dr. Michael Moody, Life After Life. Another place I feel like you can find some evidence that may lead you to have certainty in your heart that life transcends the physical body. Okay so far? All right. But if you call in the next 10 minutes, you also get instrumental transcommunication. Like a bad infomercial, I should tell you that this is not my favorite part of the whole thing. But I figured I'll put it out there anyways. ITC, also known as which stands for instrumental transcommunication, is sometimes also known as electronic voice phenomena, or EVP. And the idea here is that you place a regular recording instrument, like a phone, a recorder, in a space in a room, and then later on you hear, I play that back, and you can hear voices of the spirits talking back to you, right? And there has even been some like scary movies made about this. But Dr. Konstantin Rodiv, a Latin psychologist from the Uppsala University in Sweden, along with Dr. Jugerson, have recorded more than 100,000 sessions of EVP, electronic voice phenomena, that can happen sometimes. And I find it fascinating. And if you are interested, if that piques your curiosity, you can look for Dr. Jugerson and Dr. Rodiv as a source for more understanding in this topic. You can also look for a book by Tom and Lisa Butler from the American Association for Electronic Voice Phenomena called There Is No Death and There Are No Dead. And of course, nowadays, we become more skeptical about it because of technology, but the earlier this research is done, back in the day when we couldn't really fake, you know, tape recorders that well, it might have been more convincing, right? But ITC or EVP is something that you can look into, find that interesting. Aha, now it gets more interesting for me, at least. Mediumship. And so mediumship, I think, is a very powerful source for information about life after life. And here I'm talking about mediumship in the spiritualist sense, on the research sense. So. There has been much research to validate the idea that there is life in the beyond, and it's not something new. In fact, if we look here back in the day, we're going to see these fine gentlemen over here with great hair and a wonderful posture, which I hope I had. People like Conan Doyle, Cesare de Lombroso, and even Gabriel Delon, who are scientists of their respective eras, or at least credible sources, who researched on their own mediumship and then reached the conclusion that it was indeed possible for the spirit of those who have lived before to communicate back with us. Well, and the idea here is simple, right? If there are spirits of people who have lived before and we can talk to them, then they have survived the physical body, which again shows us that life goes on after this one ends. That maybe we ought not to look at life from an organic sense, but we should think about it more of a mental or spiritual sense. There are other researchers too. There is the famous Dr. William Crookes, who's seen over there on top, who studied the medium Florence Cook and the medium Didi Hume. Both of the mediums are down here. What you can't really see, because the picture is really small, is that the picture of a lady that you see there is actually not the medium. It's actually the materialization of the spirit using the energies of the medium. And this is fascinating because Dr. William Crookes was a member of the Royal Research Society, so he was clearly established. I believe he has a Nobel Prize for something. I can't remember now, and shame on me, Dan. I should remember this, because I find it fascinating. But he really wrote a letter to the Royal Society saying that he was convinced that this was true. This was late in his life when he already had a reputation to preserve. So he had everything to lose by writing that letter, and yet he did because he was so convinced that was possible. In there, he is doing some research with the medium who, during a period of time, materialized this spirit who tell him things and that he could grasp and touch because of materialization, which is a rare phenomena that can happen as well. But I find it fascinating because it is a man of science studying many different things, and it's a wonderful story. So if you want to look more into a very credible source, Dr. William Crookes might be a way for you to find some interesting perspective there. Later on too, we also have a French thinker, Charles Richet, we have a Russian, Alexander Aksakov, and we have the medium Eusapia Palladino, who actually lived here in Boston. And they study this medium over here, and it's fascinating study in general. But what's interesting about these studies is that they keep repeating themselves. We keep doing them. And more recently, we've had Dr. Gary Schwartz, who's actually a fantastic guy. I had the opportunity to meet him a couple of times. And Dr. Schwartz is the director of the Veritas Research Program at the Laboratory for Advanced Consciousness and Health at the Department of Psychology at the University of Arizona. It's a very long title. But what I mean to say here is, again, another researcher who has an endowed laboratory and does research as an accredited and large US-based university. And he has published a couple of books, including The Afterlife Experiments, where he shares his experiments with many different mediums to check whether it was possible for the mediums to actually know what was happening or not. And some of these mediums include Alison Dubois and John Edward. So he would put them behind different panes and have them do readings with other people and see whether they could tell they had never met before, did double-blind studies, all kinds of scientific interesting stuff. But you can read more about that in the book. It's a really easy read. And he concludes that statistically, they definitely broke the curve, that it was possible indeed to have that. And it's fascinating to see that being echoed through the times, showing that life actually go on. So if you're looking for some evidence along those lines related to mediumship, you can of course go back to Cesare Lombroso, William Crookes, Charles Richet, Aksakov, and now more recently to Dr. Gary Schwartz. So far so good? All right. Now, for us spiritists, mediumship also has a very special spot in our hearts because we have too conducted research like those thinkers before have done. The difference is that having found that life goes on our own, we have moved on from research that tries to validate that life goes on after the physical body to the implications of said event. So we spiritists, we still have mediumship meetings. In fact, we do it quite often. There are thousands of mediumship meetings probably happening right now in different spiritist centers throughout the world that further attest and repeat the fact over and over that communication with the spiritual world happens every single day. And that is one of the required scientific elements for you to arrive at a conclusion. You have to be able to repeat the phenomena multiple times, and we do that on a daily basis. And what we do in these meetings are not, it's not the pursuit of does the contact really happen? We already satisfied that. What we actually do is try to help those spirits who have not yet fully realized that they may have been, that they have passed on. We oftentimes help them deal with the idea that life goes on, because now that they find themselves on the other side, they don't know what to do, because they didn't believe that life continued, and now it does. And they find themselves at a loss. In fact, in a gross approximation, if you have seen the movie Sixth Sense, you can kind of see that it's actually quite good in many different ways. Of course, there's some extreme cases, some things in there, but the idea that oftentimes we will pass on but not know we have is one that spiritists throughout the world address on a daily basis to counseling. And of course, we also help ourselves by getting some wisdom from these spirits who gives us great messages and point us in the right direction so that we can think about the fact that maybe we are spiritual beings and not physical beings. And that therefore we should re-evaluate our perspective towards life in general. Maybe we should behave a little bit better and not be as rude or mean to our neighbor, because when they pass or when we pass, that's not going to go away. That life goes on. So we Spiritists are more interested in that. In fact, I think that's what Spiritism really offers to the world, is this wonderful book here, the Medium's Book. Of course, besides the incredible The Spirit's Book, which is everything is in there for Spiritists. But the Medium's Book is a fascinating book because it's Kardec as a researcher who codified Spiritism telling anyone who may want to reproduce this phenomena how to do it. His scientific mind was such that he understood that because he gathered all this information here on the Spirit's Book that brings us great wisdom about life in the afterlife, he also wanted to share how he acquired that information so that others could reach that conclusion on their own, therefore empowering each one of us. So if you are interested in understanding how mediumship works, how the actual mechanism and phenomena take place, then the Spirit's Book and the Medium's Book are great places for you to start. Because it is accessible to any and everybody to understand how the contact with the spiritual world works in a way that is not mystical or fantastic. That is just a matter of fact and a rule of life. And so, through the many meetings and experiences we have every single day, we have also reached a point where we believe that life goes on after the physical body. Whew, who's tired? I am. It's a lot of content, but of course there are other pieces of evidence that we could talk more about it. When you reach the idea that that God exists, if you believe in God, it is hard for you to explain the world as it is. How do you explain congenital disorders? People who are born with conditions that they have apparently done nothing to warrant them in this lifetime. If you believe in God, it's difficult to reconcile that. Because how can some have quite comfortable life and others have a really difficult life? If there is only one lifetime, it's hard to navigate that with the idea of God. Now, when you add reincarnation to the mix, then you can see that the concept of divine justice gets better explained, unfolded, and unpacked. Because you see that there is indeed a continuation of lives. That our life is really spiritual and not physical, so some events from some lives, physical lives, carry over to the ones after. And you can see the causes and consequences of things. But because we are just in that moment on time, just because we are in that picture, we miss the whole movie. We just see a frame out of this. So that's an interesting thought process that we can also do when we're talking about reconciling the idea of God and life after life. But all right, these are the brainy parts of our work. How about our emotions? Well, this is where we want to dive into, because we also want to make a point that we're lacking in emotional education. That when we are suffering so much that we think that we might want to end our lives, we oftentimes don't have the tools to address our problems and conflicts that have led us there, right? And so we want to talk a little bit about that. And this is when we bring Dr. Elizabeth Kubler-Ross too, and I apologize that the projection is getting cut out a little bit, but she has a wonderful sentence. She says, "I'm not okay. You're not okay. And that's okay." Right? Because the deal here is we all feel like we're the only ones with problems. And we think that everybody else has it figured out. You only see wonderful things with your people on Facebook. They're always traveling, they're happy, they're doing selfies, smiling in the most exotic locations. That's all up front, because all of us struggle with something. So we need to break this stigma, this idea that we cannot talk about the things that brings us down. Because keeping that bottle inside is clearly a problem. And once that accumulates over time, it may be really difficult for us to navigate that on our own. Instead, maybe we should treat our emotional education like going to the gym. That is, we have to practice it. We have to talk about it. We have to find ways of channeling our frustrations, our sadness, and dealing with it as opposed to just stuffing it deep down inside and pretending it's not there. The truth is, we're all afflicted with something. We're all fighting a battle that nobody knows about. The more we realize that everybody's going through this, the more we realize that it's okay for you to have it, these struggles. So we can also, of course, go into why that has happened. Why don't we talk about feelings? A lot of it is because we haven't learned it from our parents. School has never given us emotional education. It has always given us intellectual education. Fortunately, that is changing. And we are now learning how to deal with conflicts and talk to people and solve problems. But we never get the formal teaching from any place. But we can't blame our parents either, because they didn't get it from our grandparents. So it's up to us to, even if we are no longer young folk, to seek out ways in which we can deal with our own emotional need. And we can search for help. We can talk to people about this. And if we notice people who may be struggling with things, we should ask them, are you okay? Are you struggling? Research also shows that if you just ask people, hey, are you thinking about committing suicide? That it actually helps those who are thinking about it, because then they find the venue to say, yes, I've been struggling so much. They're unable, oftentimes, to articulate that because they feel embarrassed about it. But once you breach the topic, they are more likely to actually open up. We don't have to be experts in suicide prevention, but we should know that there are many resources out there that we can find and that we should be talking about this. So if you notice people who are even just joking about it, this is a serious matter. We should talk about it, right? And there's some tools that you can use to deal with emotions and feelings. We're not going to go through them. They are not spiritist tools, but there's some great tools here, like the Ruler Framework by Dr. Mark Brackett, who I got to meet at a conference too. He's great. He's from the Yale Center of Emotional Intelligence. He tells about recognizing emotions first, and then understanding the causes, and then labeling the emotions accordingly so that we know what they are. Because if you don't know what they are, it's hard for you to tackle it, right? Expressing your emotions appropriately and regulating emotions, that is, controlling your emotions. So that's an interesting method as well, that if you want to learn more, you can resort to that. There's also nonviolent communication, also known as compassionate communication, which is a way of troubleshooting difficult situations, a method that you can help that can help you have difficult conversations with people that are grounded in facts and observation, and that talk about your feelings and your needs, because we all have emotional needs. We just don't articulate them. I was just telling folks last night that sometimes we get back home and our partner or wife or husband says, you always get home late. Where were you? What they're really saying is, I don't know how to express my feelings very well. I really missed you, and I am let down because I wanted to spend time with you. That's what they're really saying, but we don't have the tools to say that. And so we just go into all kinds of aggressive communication sometimes. So it's important for us to know how to learn to communicate better. And if we're interested, this is one of the tools created by Marshall Rosenberg, right over here, that you can find. And of course, mindfulness in general now, it's a big wave about being present, being mindful. So there are tools out there that may allow us to deal and grapple with the challenges that we oftentimes face in the emotional arena, and that we have not been able, at least not instructed in a formal way, of dealing. But the truth is, and I think you saw it by all those numbers, emotional hardship, it's normal and constant. We have to address and we have to tackle it. We have to. We don't have an option. Because it won't go away by simply ignoring it. So we hope that more and more we will open ourselves up to each other and to those that we care, and know that we also can get help from professionals who are trained in dealing through these things, like psychologists, psychiatrists, right? That we gotta break the stigma that only crazy people go talk to professionals, right? Because we still have that somehow in our minds, and I don't know why. Because we feel like we have to have it all figured out, because everybody else does. And the truth is, nobody does. Show me somebody who's telling you that everything is wonderful in their lives, and I'll show you somebody who needs to do some soul searching. Right? You with me so far? So you might be asking, so okay, So all right then, you talked about the intellectual reasons, life after life, and research. You talked briefly about emotional education, which is a topic that we can unpack greatly. But what does Spiritism has to do with that? Well, I find that Spiritism has a lot to do with both. Because Spiritism is a dynamic body of knowledge that studies the nature, the origin, and the destiny of souls or spirits, and how they relate to the physical world. That is, Spiritism studies spirituality, ourselves as spiritual beings, and our nature. What are we? Our origin. Where do we come from? And our destiny. What is going to happen to us? What are we going to do? And how all of this relates to the physical world around us. So Spiritism has built in it, I feel, a great perspective to help us understand that this world that we're looking into is impermanent. And that we ought to understand that life goes on the physical body. And when it does, a certain sense of change and peace comes over us. Because when can we really understand all of this, we will notice that we can educate ourselves and be happier. That we can talk about the immortality of the soul, we can have an understanding of the spiritual world, and we realize that we are really constantly evolving, all of us. And if that is the case, then we should not fret. And I am reminded here, to wrap things up, of the story of Lazarus in the New Testament. It's a beautiful story, very emblematic. In it, Martha folks go to Jesus and say, hey, Lazarus has died. Can you go see him? And Jesus takes 3 days to go, right? And you might be asking, oh my God, why is it taking 3 days? Does he care about Lazarus, right? But when he gets there, Martha, his sister, says, Lord, I know Lazarus will rise again in the resurrection of the last day. That is to say, I believe in everything that you have taught us, that life goes on. I believe it, right? And Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me will live even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this? So what he says here is, the teachings that I am sharing with you, not me, myself, personally, are the way and the life. Because if you believe in these teachings, even though your physical body dies, you will never die. And that if you live believing in this, you will never pass away. And then asks her back, do you believe in this? Because it's important for us, for each one of us, to reach our own conclusions. So I've presented you information here today that may make sense to you, it may not, and that's okay if it doesn't. And if it doesn't, toss it aside. It's important for you to find the stuffing that will help you make sense of the world. For many of us, Spiritism has been a powerful ally. But you see that even outside of Spiritism, with science and different things, all of it points to this certainty that we, in fact, are Lazarus. We are the ones who are coming back into life by realizing that this impermanent world of us will end, but who we are does not. And when that happens, when we see the whole picture and we realize that we are souls, immortal spirits, then two things I think should happen in our hearts, at least happen in mine. The first one is become more tolerant with each other, because all of us are struggling and are trying to be better people through many lifetimes. All of us are work in progress. So it's easier for us to become a little bit more tolerant. And the second is, if we have lived before many times, then we must also reach the realization that we have had many affections and many friends before, some of which might not be here with us right now, who might be preparing to have a different incarnation. And do you think that the love that they have for us disappears when they die? Does our love for loved ones who have passed over end? No, right? So their love for us doesn't end either. So in fact, we have an army of love, not only here, but in the other side of life, that is cheering us on, that cares for us so deeply, maybe mothers and fathers from before, maybe husbands and wives, children, cousins, parakeets, dogs, who knows? But we've lived so many different lifetimes and not always with the same people. So there's all this army of love for us, speaking to us from beyond the grave that we simply don't recall. Because right now, as we are going to work, like we go every day in a physical life, we are in a physical body and we forget that we are spiritual beings. Were we to remember that and arrive at the realization that there is an incredible number of souls cheering for us, rooting for us, we would never feel alone for a second. And we will be reminded that all the challenges we see today are temporary. And that there is a God. And if there is a God, the challenges we face are conquerable. Because a God would never give us a problem that we cannot solve. That would be mean. We might not solve it the way we want to, but all our challenges are manageable. And so with that in mind, I hope that you will continue to remember that you're a spiritual being and that there's plenty of evidence out there in science and in our hearts to point to the fact that the soul does indeed outlive the body and that we are immortal spirits who will never end. And so, look around. Our love would only grow. The friends you make today would only be added to your plethora of friends in the beyond. So the spiritual family that we always talk about, it is a reality. And the more we go on, the more we live, the more love we bring into our lives. So never forget for a second that you're a creature of God, immortal, and that the whole universe belongs to you, and that there is way more love out there for you than you will ever know. Thank you so much. I appreciate your time today. Yeah.
As nossas reflexões. Para quem quiser depois rever, porque a gente recebeu muita informação, o Daniel vai fazer ali a edição do vídeo, a gente vai postar. Tem muita informação importante que acredito que pode nos ajudar muito, né? Então, nós vamos convidar todos para, mais uma vez, nos reunirmos em prece,